The Holy Gospel according to St. John. A curious Pharisee named Nicodemus visits Jesus by night to learn from the teacher his friends reject. Jesus speaks to him about life in the Spirit and the kingdom of God. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God." Jesus answered him, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." Nicodemus said to him, "How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit," Nicodemus said to him. "How can these things be?" Jesus answered him, "Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet do you not understand these things? Very truly I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen. Yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." The Gospel of the Lord.
We'll begin with a word of prayer together. O Lord, may your holy wind, your Holy Spirit blow through us this morning, assembled here in this little ship called Resurrection. May you fill our sails so that we can sail into new mission fields, new adventures with you, with your anchor being your love for us on the cross. Amen. I don't know if you've ever been to a baseball game, either pro or minor league, when an animal gets loose on the field, like a squirrel or a dog. But there was a story about a dog, pictured on the screen here, a little dachshund got loose on a field down in Texas one time. And he trotted around the infield and had a great time in the outfield, everybody trying to catch him, and he just thought it was wonderful. And finally, he landed on second base, as you see pictured here. And the crowd just loved this, of course. And they yelled things at him, things like steal third, you know, or bite the umpire, or just good for you, or get off the field. And there was such a mix of voices that he just didn't know what to do until, as you see, finally a member of the grounds crew came and scooped him up and carried him off. And a writer who had a dog said that probably what was going on was for this poor dog was there were so many voices yelling at him, there was no one dominant voice that he could obey. And thus he was very confused. You know, that's kind of how life is sometimes. We're like that dog on second base or running around in the outfield, and we have choices that come across our lives, and we maybe have a lot of voices that call us to do one thing or the other or go one direction or the other. It might be an inner voice. It might be the voice of a family member. It might be a voice at work, a boss or a coworker. If you're a student, it might be a friend in school calling you to do one thing or the other. Life is like that dog on the field. And sometimes we don't know where to go. And we need a dominant voice, a voice with authority that we can know is true and trustworthy. And you hear that voice today, you just heard it, the voice of Jesus, our Lord, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. What he says to us about life is the dominant voice. So let's kind of overhear this interesting conversation from long ago between Jesus and a man named Nicodemus. First of all, we learn a few things about him, that he was an important man, a Pharisee, a ruler of the Jews, I think is what the text says, meaning that he was one of 71 men that were a part of a group called the Sanhedrin. And they play a very big role in this story as it marches along toward the cross. They will reappear in the story on what we call Maundy Thursday night, where Jesus is betrayed in the garden, and then you may remember he is brought before a group to be tried in the middle of the night. That's that Sanhedrin group, and Nicodemus is part of them, one of 71. Then we hear that he comes at night. Why not in the daytime, you might ask? Well, we know in this story up till this point, the Pharisees were not happy with what Jesus was doing or saying. Nicodemus is one of them. It's dangerous for him to have a conversation in the daylight with Jesus. And there's something else going on here. I don't know if you like mysteries and code language and so on, but the Gospel of John is sort of a mystery with some clues, some code language. And one of those code language or code words is darkness or night. When that word pops up in a story, there's more going on there than just that it's dark physically. But it's also, for John, a time of unbelief or temptation or ignorance. Nicodemus comes at a time in his life when he is an unbeliever. But if you go to the end of the story in John chapter 19, Jesus dies on the cross, and you know who puts him in the tomb? Two guys, Joseph of Arimathea and his friend Nicodemus. Something has happened from this chapter to that chapter. He's come along on a road of faith, and now he is again taking a risk to put Jesus in the tomb. You see a couple of examples on the screen from John's writing about this light and darkness idea. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light, here it comes, shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. And then there's a second one there about how people love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. When is Jesus betrayed? At night. When does Peter deny knowing Jesus? At night. Bad stuff happens at night because that is the realm of unbelief. Well, let's move on and eavesdrop some more on this fascinating conversation between Nicodemus and Jesus. And as you see on the screen, they talk now for a while about this mysterious new birth. And we read things like, it comes from above. It's not something that is manufactured by a human being, but it comes from the outside in. It is necessary in order to enter the kingdom of heaven or God. And it's like a gust of wind, Jesus says. It reminds us of a verse that you come across when you open up any Bible and you turn to the first page of Genesis, and you run into this in the corner there on the upper right. And the Spirit of God moved over the force or the face of the waters, or the wind of God. That's how the Spirit is understood in the Bible, as a wind blowing, and you don't know where it goes and where it comes from. And as you see in the Luther quote, he understood that meaning baptism, that baptism is when we receive that new birth. It comes from the outside. It's nothing we muster up by our own decision or anything like that. It's a gift for us. Let's think about the wind a little more. If you drive around Iowa, and particularly up in, northwest Iowa, you see a lot of wind farms. Ever notice that? As you're driving on 35 toward Minnesota, off to the left or the west, there are all these wind farms that have been developed. We try to harness the wind to power our homes and our communities, but we can't really control when it blows and when it doesn't, can we? If you've ever been out on a sailboat, any sailors here in Iowa? Okay. If you've ever been out on a sailboat on a lake or a canoe, probably that's maybe more something we've done, you know the feeling of being at the mercy of the wind. There's kind of three things that a wind can do for you, at least. It can be at your back, it can be in your face, or you can be what we call dead in the water when there's no wind. And if you're in a sailboat, only one of those three things is really a good thing. Having the wind at your back, you fly over the water. But if you're in a sailboat and there's no wind, you're like that image on the right where the sea is calm. And if you've ever been in a canoe, I know some of you looking around have done this, like up in the Boundary Waters on those big lakes like Lake Saginaw, and you're canoeing into a headwind, it feels like you're going nowhere. Those waves are coming, crashing over the front of your canoe, and you paddle as hard as you can, but you look and you're really just where you were a little bit ago. You're just not getting anywhere. And you know, that's a parable of our life of faith, I think. Because sometimes in our lives, we feel like the Spirit's wind is at our back. We have a picture there of our Edge group from, where was that, in St. Louis or last fall? They went on a mission trip to St. Louis, and when they're all gathered together on a trip like that, or this summer on their mission trip, it kind of perhaps can feel for them like the wind is at their back. And it's an exciting, they're just kind of flying over the face of the water, and life is good. Or perhaps for you that are adults, maybe if you've ever helped at a Habitat for Humanity build, and you pound those, you know, nails into 2x4s, and you watch that house come up, and you feel good inside about it, that's a time when the wind is at your back. And congregations can feel this too. Almost 60 years ago, this congregation was started in a school in another part of town, and that, I'm sure, was a day where those folks felt the wind at their back. Or when we moved out here, which is more kind of what you folks remember, perhaps back in 2004 in this month of March, that too was a day where we walked into this incredible space and felt the Spirit just sort of blowing us in here, and the wind was at our back. But then there are other times where we feel dead in the water spiritually. The ancient mystics called this spiritual deserts, or dark nights of the soul, where God seems absent. We feel forsaken. The Bible doesn't speak to us like it used to. Our prayers seem to go nowhere. Worship doesn't move us like it used to. You've hit a plateau in your spiritual life. And the same thing happens for congregations. Interestingly, after you do something like this, they have done studies, and about 5 or so years later, attendance does tend to plateau because the excitement is over. The new is no longer new. And, you know, when we moved out here, we just had so many people coming to see the new building and experience the new worship and so on. But it's kind of typical to hit that plateau after a period of time. And then there are times when the wind isn't at your back or you're not dead in the water, but it's in your face as a Christian or as a congregation. And you don't really know where to go. We've told the story once in a while about St. Paul in modern-day Turkey facing a strong headwind. As you see on the map, he had traveled by foot all the way through on one of his missionary journeys. And then you get these strange stories from the book of Acts, particularly look at the words highlighted in yellow, how he's in what we would say is kind of northwest Turkey, and he wants to go one direction or the other, but it says the Spirit forbids him from going north or south. What's that about? And then he has this vision in the night where a man from Macedonia, which is across the sea in what we would call Greece, says, come over here. Come over here and help us. And St. Paul and his friends hop in a boat and go to where the new possibilities lie for them. His question in Turkey is, which way should we go? The vision says, come over here. He moves from being puzzled to possibilities. You know that we've done this map survey recently, and I want to reveal something that it said about us as a congregation. We had over 200 responses, which we thank you again for, and we hope that again you will fill out the next one, the final one we're going to do. But there were some questions in that about kind of where do you see where we're at. And on this survey, there are kind of four quadrants that you can be in as a congregation. You can feel stuck, kind of dead in the water. You can feel that the view is just fine from here. That's nostalgic. You know, don't change anything. It's just right. The lower left-hand corner, you can be puzzled as a congregation, wondering which way should we go. And fourthly, you can be a congregation where the possibilities are exciting, and you say, let's get going. Paul, in that map that we just looked at, was between puzzled and possibilities. He was saying, which way do we go? He had this vision in the night, and the vision said, come over to Greece or Macedonia. And he said to his friends, let's get going. You see that red symbol there? I know it's kind of hard to see perhaps, between the I and the S on the map up there, in the word promised. That is where resurrection is. Okay? We're, according to this survey, we are somewhere between puzzled and possibilities, between which way should we go and let's get going. Okay? That's not a bad place to be, I don't think. Not bad at all. That's where Paul was in northwest Asia or in northwest Turkey. And he obeyed that call of the Spirit, and the world was never the same. And may we have that same Spirit's call for us in our boat called resurrection. And may we always remember, too, that our anchor is Jesus and his death on the cross. You hear that in that classic great verse from John 3:16. That is what grounds us, that is what anchors us, no matter which way the Spirit blows, knowing that great truth keeps us on our path. And this good news about Jesus and his death and resurrection can and does change human lives. I want to end with a story right now about a Muslim man from Iran. Muslims from Iran are not getting a lot of good press lately, but we want to hear his story about how he came to America at the time of the Iranian Revolution with the Ayatollah Khomeini, and find out what happened to him in this country. If we can have that, please.
I actually grew up not too far from here. I grew up in Iran. And in 1979, I saw religion destroy my country. Religion gone wrong cost the lives of over a million people in Iran. My dad was a religious man, but not too devout. But he was also a military man. And so when the Iranian Revolution happened, we escaped religion. We had to get out of Iran because the government was overthrown by Ayatollah Khomeini and his zealots. And so when we escaped and we came to America as refugees, basically, we came, and in my mind as a little boy, we were escaping religion and God's representation. And so for years and years in America, I wanted to have nothing to do with anything that had a cross, a crescent, or a star, or anything on it. Well, one day, a buddy of mine invited me to go to church with him. Now, he wasn't really a devout Christian. He was just hanging out with me, and he invited me to church. And this was after high school, and I told him, I said, look, I don't want to go to church. I hate religion. I told him all the reasons. I told him how it had destroyed my country. But my buddy said, no. This isn't Muslim stuff, man. This is Christian stuff. And I'd seen Christianity on TV, honestly. I'd seen people with big hair sitting in a golden chair, you know, saying, Jesus loves you, show me the money or whatever. And so I told him all the reasons I didn't want to go to church. And instead of giving up, he ends up giving me the name of five of the hottest girls from our school. And he says, look, they all go to my church. And so I felt motivated to go visit. And I gotta admit, I went for the wrong reason the first time I ever went. But when I went there, I saw not religion, but grace. I saw real people, not religious people, not people who acted really cleaned up, but just forgiven people who were dealing with everyday life stuff, but there was something different about them. The grace of God had made them gracious, had made them graceful. And every Monday, these people would come and visit me. They had this thing called visitation. And I'm telling you, every time they came over, all they talked about was Jesus Christ. They didn't talk about all the things I was doing wrong. Instead, they kept telling me about all the things that Jesus had done right. And Jesus, to me, was a religious figure. And so I kept telling them, I don't want to have anything to do with religion. And they would say, we don't either. This isn't about religion. This is about Jesus. Well, one night, I went to their church. They dragged me there. And when I was there, I heard this preacher preach. We're talking about an old school Southern Baptist preacher. Guy with a comb over, and he's like, come on down, we'll condemn you and the kids. You're going frying the head like a piece of sausage, you know? And he was passionate, but when you're lost, you don't see it as passion, you see it as anger. I remember thinking, man, if the gospel is such good news, why is this guy so mad? But I didn't realize he just believed enough in what he knew to be the truth that he wanted me to hear it. And that night, I felt convicted because he was telling me the truth. But when you're lost, you don't see it as conviction. You really see it as a guilt trip. So during the invitation, while other people were going forward, I hit the aisle and I went the other way to get away from church. Well, I went home and I realized something, that God is omnipresent. He's everywhere. He's not just contained in little church buildings. And when I got there, God continued to convict me. I eventually opened up a Bible in my room really late at night. I was home all by myself that night and started to read. And I read a story about a man named Peter who on a stormy night was called out by Jesus to step out of a boat. That Bible all of a sudden jumped out at me. In an instant, God said, David, I want you to step out and I want you to trust me. Just as Jesus was saying to Peter, come, he was saying to me, come. I just hit one knee and I said, Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I know you're the only hope that I have for cleansing. I know you're the only hope I have for salvation. I offer all of myself to you. I submit my life to you. Everything changed that night. That night, the old me died and a whole new me was born again. But I realized that moment was this, that Christianity is not about bad people becoming good. That's religion. Christianity is about dead people becoming alive in Christ. The night that I became a Christian, my parents hit the roof. When they found out that I'd given my life to Jesus, my dad became very devout as a Muslim instantly. He was like, you can't be a Christian, we're Muslims. And I was like, we are? We'd never been really that devout. But then he thought, you know what? It's just a stage in David's life. He's got a tennis racket because he wanted to be Andre Agassi. He's got a guitar, and all the guitar lessons never panned out. He's done all these different things. He's got a surfboard, even though we live 4 hours away from any body of water. Let him just have a Bible, and he'll get over religion. But they didn't realize that when you give your life to Jesus, when you really do that, it's not like a cold, a Christian cold that you catch and it goes away. It's a whole new you. And the night that I went to get baptized at my church, I got kicked out of the house for my faith. But within 5 years, the same parents that kicked me out of the house, one by one, my entire family, not just my mom, not just my dad, but my sister and my brother, had come to know Christ as their Savior.
The wind blows where it wills, and may it blow into your heart this day. Amen. Please stand.